Random House Audio presents South of the Border, West of the Sun by Haruki Murakami. Read for you by Eric Loren. 1. My birthday is the 4th of January, 1951, the first week of the first month of the first year of the second half of the 20th century. Something to commemorate, I guess, which is why my parents named me Hajime, beginning in Japanese. Other than that, 100% average birth. My father worked in a large brokerage firm. My mother was a typical housewife. During the war, my father was drafted as a student and sent to fight in Singapore. After the surrender, he spent some time in a POW camp. My mother's house was burned down in a B-29 raid during the final year of the war. Their generation suffered most during the long war. When I was born, though, you'd never have known there'd been a war. No more burned-out ruins. No more occupation army. We lived in a small, quiet town in a house my father's company provided. The house was pre-war. Somewhat old, but roomy enough. Pine trees grew in the garden. And we even had a small pond. And some stone lanterns. The town I grew up in was your typical middle-class suburbia. The classmates I was friendly with all lived in neat little row houses. Some might have been a bit larger than mine, but you could count on them all having similar entranceways, pine trees in the garden. The works. My friends' fathers were employed in companies or else were professionals of some sort. Hardly anyone's mother worked. And most everyone had a cat or a dog. No one I knew lived in an apartment or a condo. Later on, I moved to another part of town, but it was pretty much identical. The upshot of this is that until I moved to Tokyo to go to college, I was convinced everyone in the whole world lived in a single-family home with a garden and a pet, and commuted to work decked out in a suit. I couldn't for the life of me imagine a different lifestyle. In the world I grew up in, a typical family had two or three children. My childhood friends were all members of such stereotypical families. If not two kids in the family, then three. If not three, then two. Families with six or seven kids were few and far between, but even more unusual were families with only one child. I happened to be one of the unusual ones, since I was an only child. I had an inferiority complex about it, as if there was something different about me, that what other people all had and took for granted, I lacked. I detested the term only child. Every time I heard it, I felt something was missing from me, like I wasn't quite a complete human being. The phrase only child stood there, pointing an accusatory finger at me. Something's not quite all there, pal, it told me. In the world I lived in, it was an accepted idea that only children were spoiled by their parents, weak and self-centered. This was a given, like the fact that the barometer goes down the higher up you go, and the fact that cows give milk. That's why I hated it whenever someone asked me how many brothers and sisters I had. Just let them hear I didn't have any, and instinctively, they thought, an only child, eh? Spoiled, weak, and self-centered, I betcha. That kind of knee-jerk reaction depressed me and hurt. But what really depressed and hurt me was something else. The fact that everything they thought about me was true. I really was spoiled, weak, and self-centered. In the 6 years I went to elementary school, I met just one other only child, so I remember her. Yes, it was a girl, very well. I got to know her well, and we talked about all sorts of things. We understood each other. You could even say, I loved her. Her last name was Shimamoto. Soon after she was born, she came down with polio, which made her drag her left leg. On top of that, she transferred to our school at the end of fifth grade. Compared to me then, she had a terrible load of psychological baggage to struggle with. This baggage, though, only made her a tougher, more self-possessed only child than I could ever have been. She never whined or complained, never gave any indication of the annoyance she must have felt at times. No matter what happened, she'd manage a smile. The worse things got, in fact, the broader her smile became. I loved her smile. It soothed me, encouraged me. "It'll be all right," her smile told me. "Just hang in there, and everything will turn out okay." Years later, whenever I thought of her, it was her smile that came to mind first. Shimamoto always got good grades and was kind to everyone. People respected her. We were both only children, but in this sense, she and I were different. This doesn't mean, though, that all our classmates liked her. No one teased her or made fun of her, but except for me, she had no real friends. She was probably too cool, too self-possessed. Some of our classmates must have thought her cold and haughty. But I detected something else, something warm and fragile just below the surface. Something very much like a child playing hide-and-seek, hidden deep within her, yet hoping to be found. Because her father was transferred a lot, Shimamoto had attended quite a few schools. I can't recall what her father did. Once she explained to me in detail what he did, but as with most kids, it went in one ear and out the other. I seem to recall some professional job connected with a bank or a tax office or something. She lived in company housing, but the house was larger than normal, a Western-style house with a low, solid stone wall surrounding it. Above the wall was an evergreen hedge, and through gaps in the hedge, you could catch a glimpse of a garden with a lawn. Shimamoto was a large girl, about as tall as I was, with striking features. I was certain that in a few years she would be gorgeous, but when I first met her, she hadn't developed an outer look to match her inner qualities. Something about her was unbalanced, and not many people felt she was much to look at. There was an adult part of her, and a part that was still a child, and they were out of sync. And this out-of-sync quality made people uneasy. Probably because our houses were so close, literally a stone's throw from each other, the first month after she came to our school, she was assigned to the seat next to mine. I brought her up to speed on what text she'd need, what the weekly tests were like, how much we covered in each book, how the cleaning and the dishing out lunch assignments were handled. Our school's policy was for the child who lived nearest any transfer student to help him or her out. My teacher took me aside to let me know that he expected me to take special care of Shimamoto with her lame leg. As with all kids of 11 or 12, talking with a member of the opposite sex for the first time, for a couple of days, our conversations were strained. When we found out we were both only children, though, we relaxed. It was the first time either of us had met a fellow only child. We had so much we'd held inside about being only children. Often we'd walk home together. Slowly, because of her leg, we'd walk the 3/4 of a mile home talking about all kinds of things. The more we talked, the more we realized we had in common. Our love of books and music, not to mention cats. We both had a hard time explaining our feelings to others. We both had a long list of foods we didn't want to eat. When it came to subjects at school, the ones we liked, we had no trouble concentrating on. The ones we disliked, we hated to death. But there was one major difference between us. More than I did, Shimamoto consciously wrapped herself inside a protective shell. Unlike me, she made an effort to study the subject she hated. And she got good grades. When the school lunch contained food she hated, she still ate it. In other words, she constructed a much taller defensive wall around herself than I ever built. What remained behind that wall, though, was pretty much what lay behind mine. Unlike times when I was with other girls, I could relax with Shimamoto. I loved walking home with her. Her left leg limped slightly as she walked. We sometimes took a breather on a park bench halfway home, but I didn't mind. Rather, the opposite. I was glad to have the extra time. Soon, we began to spend a lot of time together. But I don't recall anyone kidding us about it. This didn't strike me at the time, though now it seems strange. After all, kids that age naturally tease and make fun of any couple who seem close.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.